Welcome to the third Advocate Shahid Azmi Memorial Lecture. As you know, this memorial lecture has been organized in the memory of Advocate Shahid Azmi, who was a lawyer practicing in several courts, trial courts in Maharashtra and also High Court, Bombay High Court. And he was killed in 2010, 11th February. 2010. He's been representing a number of accused, terror accused, and in fact, you might recall that he was himself accused of being a terrorist. He spent around 5 years in Tihar jail, and after his acquittal, and once he came out of jail, he studied law and journalism. First, practiced journalism for a time being, and then decided to pursue litigation and practice law. We have been organizing this lecture since 2012, but this is the only third. In between, we could not organize lectures. The first lecture was delivered by Advocate Mukul Sinha, who was a lawyer in Ahmedabad. We all know about him. A book which is distributed here. The first lecture, copy of the first lecture is there in that book. The second lecture was delivered by Advocate Yug Mohit Chaudhary in this hall only on the issue of capital punishment in 2013. So and this lecture, third lecture, we are pleased to have Bela Bhatia, who is an activist, writer, and a researcher, for a long time researcher on the issues of security, conflict, human rights. We are also thankful to Advocate Sanjay Hegde for chairing this lecture. Over to Advocate Hegde. Thank you.
Good evening. I propose to just speak to you, and I think standing up to speak, sometimes there is a formalism about it, which I do not necessarily think is the best idea. When we are talking about democratic rights and political responsibilities in the conflict zone, it's my honor and privilege to welcome Bela Bhatia. Bela Bhatia has been one of the many soldiers of our constitution. That phrase I've borrowed from Teesta Settlewad's description of ourselves, of herself. The point is that constitutions are very easily written. They're as easily observed in the breach. Every constitutional right needs people to be soldiers for it, needs people to fight it on the ground, and also needs people to fight for it in the courts. You've heard about how Shahid fought for it both on the ground as well as in the courts. He unfortunately paid with his own life. But every soldier of the Constitution does not necessarily end up as a martyr to the Constitution. Every fight for the Constitution sometimes is our little contribution to that great parchment that our ancestors left us and that we continue as a living document. When Bela here fights just for tribal women to be able to register their rape case in one of the most mineral-rich states of India, but a relatively poor state, that of Chhattisgarh. When the administration comes up and tries to shut her down, when the administration goes after her landlord, when the administration creates certain problems to ensure that the fight, if any, is taken away from the doorsteps of the administration, that is when her fight resonates with all of us, achieves a larger than life dimension. It is not relevant only to the only to Chhattisgarh, because every battle in Chhattisgarh, or every battle in Kashmir, every battle in Manipur, every battle in every city and town of India to ensure that the policeman sticks to the law, that he operates within the framework of the law, that our constitutional machinery exists to keep him not as a colonial master or as an inheritor of a colonial state, but as a servant of the democratic constitution. That is the fight that Bela and many others like her fight for. It's not as if constitutions are only for the courts to defend. Mr. Nariman recently wrote an article where he quoted Justice Leonard Hand, one of the finest judges who never made it to the Supreme Court of the US. And he didn't make it also probably because he had an activist past himself. Justice Hand is known for many things, but there's one short speech of him in 1944 where, amidst the clash of war, where people were taking the Pledge of Allegiance as American citizens and were becoming new citizens, he told them exactly what it meant and what liberty meant. And I can think of no better thing to tell you all except to quote the relevant passage. Justice Hand says, "We sought liberty, freedom from oppression, freedom from want, freedom to be ourselves. This then we sought, this then we now believe that we are sure, we are by way of winning. What do we mean when we say that first of all we seek liberty? I often wonder whether we do not rest our hopes too much upon constitutions, upon laws, and upon courts. These are false hopes, believe me. These are false hopes. Liberty lies in the hearts of men and women. And when it dies there, no constitution, no law, no court can save it. No constitution, no law, no court can even do much to help it. While it lies there, that is in the hearts of men and women, it needs no constitution, no law, no court to save it. And what is this liberty which must lie in the hearts of men and women? It's not the ruthless, the unbridled will. It's not the freedom to do as one likes. That is the denial of liberty and leads us straight to its overthrow. A society in which men recognize no check upon their freedom soon becomes a society where freedom is the possession of only a savage few, as we have learned to our sorrow. What then is the spirit of liberty? I cannot define it. I can tell you my own faith. The spirit of liberty is the spirit which is not too sure that it is right. It is the spirit. The spirit of liberty is the spirit which seeks to understand the minds of other men and women. The spirit of liberty is the spirit which weighs their interest alongside its own without bias. The spirit of liberty remembers that not even a sparrow falls to earth unheeded. The spirit of liberty is the spirit of him who near 2,000 years ago taught mankind that lesson it has never learned but never quite forgotten. That there may be a kingdom where the least shall be heard and considered side by side with the greatest." Here, ladies and gentlemen, is somebody who has fought to ensure that the least may be considered against the interests of some of the greatest corporates of India. Ladies and gentlemen, it's my proud privilege to present to you Bela Bhatia.
Friends, I'm thankful to be here with all of you today. In I'm thankful to be here with all of you today in remembering somebody who fought and who died for his convictions and who lived courageously. Shahid, we remember you and we will try our best in our own lives to follow your example. The situation in Bastar today is symptomatic of the situation in our country. A war rages, in some places more visible than others. We have a fair idea of the contours of this war. In many ways, it is an old war. It has a name: fascism, capitalism, authoritarianism. The onslaught is a political one, an economic one, a social one. The onslaught is a violent one. The nature of this onslaught is such that it has no time for ideas. Its concentration is on orders and the implementation. A deeper analysis on this attack on democracy is required in order for us to understand how do we extricate ourselves from this crisis and move ahead on the road to freedom for all. Bastar is not new to conflicts. In the colonial period, we have available accounts of several rebellions in the 18th, the 19th, the 20th centuries. Some of these rebellions, like the Bhumkal Rebellion of 1910, celebrated each year on 10th February as Bhumkal Divas, a part of the Adivasi annual calendar. The etymology of the word Bhumkal relates it to Bhum, meaning earth or land, and the Bhumkal Rebellion occurred when large tracts of forest land were being taken over and categorized as reserved forests by the British. Like other tribal rebellions of the colonial period, rebellions in Bastar too were about fighting for their identity, for their culture, about their control over what was theirs, their land and forests. Ultimately, these battles were about sovereignty. When they fought the aggressor, they fought for the history, the idea of who they were, knowledge that they had gained through their oral tradition. The Adivasis of Bastar were fortunate in some who ruled them, like Prabhi Chand. The last Raja who continued to support the struggles of the people even after 1948, after the state became part of the Indian Union. He was shot dead by the police at the steps of the palace in Jagdalpur in 1966 and continues to be remembered today. Modern day Bastar was the largest district of India, when still part of Madhya Pradesh. After the formation of Chhattisgarh in 2000, Bastar has got subdivided into 7 districts. These districts are largely rural and forested. The importance of forests and trees in the lives of the tribal inhabitants, who comprise roughly 2/3 of the total population, are reflected even in their names. For example, Marias, the largest of the Adivasi communities, can be seen to have derived the name from the Gondi word Mara, meaning a tree. Likewise, the Muriyas of North Bastar may have derived the name from Mur, that is a root in Gondi. The Naxalite CPIML People's War Group first moved into Bastar in 1980 and were using the areas adjacent to Telangana, the main center of the activity then, as a shelter zone. With time, however, their influence spread, and not unlike other tribal areas of the country, Bastar too has been witness to an in-migration of non-tribals for 200 years or so, who came with a wide variety of business interests. Over the decades, a section of these non-tribals have become powerful economically and politically, and the Adivasis have been marginalized. It was mainly to end the exploitation by the police and the forest department on the one hand, and non-tribal traders and moneylenders on the other, that the Naxalite movement took root in the hills and the forests of the region. For the Naxalites, their work in the Dandakaranya region, including Bastar, was an experiment of a kind, since they tried to develop it as a model area where, besides the politics of resistance, they also aim to put into practice their ideas regarding development. As has also happened in other states of the country, like Bihar, the Naxalites' attempt to organize the people met with resistance from some quarters. The initial resistance in Bastar, called the Jan Jagran Abhiyan, that was unarmed and largely non-violent, that was led by the Congress and the CPI, started in 1989 in Bijapur district of Bijapur Tehsil of that time undivided Dantewada district, but it fizzled out in less than 2 years due to conflicts and contradictions within the organization. In the following years, except for one or two, all the main protagonists of the Jan Jagran Abhiyan were killed by the Naxalites. However, mid-2005 was to see discontent emerge again with Naxalite actions in one village of Bijapur Tehsil. The discontent took the form of organized dissent when some notable tribal and non-tribal elites gave it the shape of a counter-insurgency movement known as the Salwar Judum with the help of the government. News about Salwar Judum first started coming out in June 2005. We heard stories of thousands of Adivasis who had been rendered homeless due to intimidation and violence of the Salwar Judum mobs and who were in relief camps. It took some time for the contours and substance of Salwar Judum to become clear and to realize that the marauders were also the ones who had organized the relief and that this was not a spontaneous popular resistance against the Naxalite movement as the state was making it out to be, but a state's supported, sponsored, backed operation, backed by massive funds, armed forces, and most seriously, impunity. We could see that this latest counterinsurgency strategy included attempting to create a divide on ethnic lines by pitting one group of Adivasis, allegedly pro-Naxalites, against another group of Adivasis and non-Adivasi settlers who made up the Salwar Judum. The repercussions of this new experiment have been severe. Many people have been killed, women raped, houses burnt. Over 1 lakh Adivasis were displaced from their homes by 2006, said then to be the largest instance of displacement in the country. Many people have also lost their lives and been displaced due to the Maoist violence, even in that period and before. Despite several criticism in the media and ongoing court cases in the High Court of Chhattisgarh and the Supreme Court of India, the war on the ground has continued in the shape of one operation after another, Operation Green Hunt, Operation Haka, etc., with scant respect for the rule of law. Today it's been 12 years of this war. And sadly, I mean, there is no respite. I mean, almost the same kind of, you know, incidents occur on a daily basis. The tribal residents of the war zone live as though in a cage. Their movements have become severely restricted in the last decade. Many of those who had run away across the borders to Telangana during the height of the first phase of the counterinsurgency in 2005 and 2006 have become permanent settlers there. Families have got divided, communities have got dispersed. For many years, these displaced families could not cultivate the lands or could do so only furtively. Those whose houses had been burnt but remained unoccupied fell apart. Their belongings were looted and the greatest wealth in the shape of cattle and livestock was lost, died, or became feral. During these years, the government had also withdrawn all welfare services, be they schools or health centers or the public distribution system, from the conflict areas and restricted these only to those who were in the camps. Many schools had also been demolished or blasted by the Maoists, who did not want them to be occupied by the security forces. Most of these villages in the interior regions are not electrified and road connectivity is poor. Thus, what the people had by way of public services in any case was quite minimal, and even that was no longer available to them. Those who had run away to Telangana were not eligible for these services there either. The war, therefore, has caused much hardship to people. Over the years, even though many families have returned, rebuilt their homes, and resumed farming, the situation is far from normal. Armed actions by Maoists as well as counterinsurgency operations continue on an everyday basis. Besides fake encounters, instances of sexual violence, use of draconian laws like the UAPA and the CSPSA, there are other methods deployed by the state which often do not come to light. For instance, during the searching and the combing operations by the security forces through the villages, it is very common to find them helping themselves to rice, cooking oil, and other edible items like poultry. Cash and ornaments get stolen. And when women have demanded money, they have, you know, often been beaten and even raped, as happened in Belamnendra village of Basagoda Thana in Bijapur in January 2016. In this particular instance, as many as 13 women were raped by the security forces. And prior to this, in October 2015, during a searching and a combing operation through 5 villages, an instance of mass gang rape occurred in one of the villages called Peddagelur, where 3 women were raped, and there were other instances of severe sexual assault. And in almost every, you know, all these villages, you know, these kind of stories you hear, which never in some ways, I mean, even though they may become part of a police complaint, they may be told to journalists, but then it's so everyday that, you know, it's not really sort of, and the other, like in comparison to that, the other atrocity is, you know, so serious that often, you know, this gets, you know, is not given enough attention. But you can imagine, you know, for a people and for a, you know, for years on end, if this is what happens, that how dislocated, you know, they must feel, and, you know, what it must mean to them, you know, in terms of their, you know, economic levels, economic survival on a, you know, daily basis. Beatings are very common. And again, this is something that, you know, doesn't get registered. Very often, you know, you go to the villages to cover an atrocity, and then, of course, you hear the story of the atrocity, and then, you know, they may point out to you, you know, they will show you the marks which may have stayed even after a few days. And there have been instances where just because of these beatings, somebody has died. It's a very common thing that you go to investigate one atrocity, and while, you know, investigating that atrocity, you actually find many more that had occurred in that region. So for instance, when we went to Kunna in Sukma district, where in that same dates, that is January, when the rapes that happened in Belamnendra in Bijapur, almost in the same dates in Kunna village in Sukma, also in a similar you know, combing operation, there was an instance of severe sexual assault. So while we were investigating into that, actually we came across somebody called Lalu Sodi. Somebody asked us, aren't you going to his house? And we didn't know, you know, so what had happened, you know, why? And so what we found out was that Lalu Sodi, because usually what happens is when the forces come, most of the men tend to run away because they are the ones who, you know, get immediately targeted. So, and, you know, it is always said that why do they run away if they're not guilty, you know, why do they run away? But, for example, now this instance shows, like when Lalu Sodi did not run away, he was, you know, cultivating, he was in his field, and they surrounded him, they beat him up so badly that he came, you know, home in the evening, and all he could drink was a little bit of page. This is what his mother related the story. And the next morning, you know, he died. And by, I think that later that evening, you know, he was even cremated. So you can imagine, you know, what it means that somebody from your family who went to the field, you know, is expected to come back and, you know, without any further, any drastic, nothing, you know, nothing has happened. He's not part of the, you know, Maoists or, you know, he's not a father or anything like that. And, you know, yet through beatings so severe that he lost his life. And the most shocking thing, that the family, being the situation that prevails there, does not think of, you know, that no, we must fight, we have to, you know, go and lodge the FIR, or we have to go and, you know, lodge a complaint, you know, we have to see to it that a postmortem is done. So, you know, so instead, you know, the person straight away is cremated. So there are, by the story of Lalu Sodhi, I mean, one thing which needs to be emphasized is that the number of stories that we get to hear, the actual reality is actually far, far worse. And there are many, many stories which we actually don't get to hear. So, especially when people are being questioned, you know, when they are trying to protest, that is when, you know, the beatings happen. Illegal and wrongful confinement is very common. Individuals, especially youth, may get picked up from the public places like the market or from the forest, and family members may not know about their whereabouts for a few days and may spend the time going from police station looking for them, which in these areas is difficult since a lot of traveling has to be done on foot. You must have heard about the very recent case in this place called Chinta Gufa, where, you know, 7 tribals have been missing. So for 7 days, like, nobody knows about their whereabouts. And Soni Sori, you know, had taken up that case. Generally, people from the interior villages considered to be strongholds of the Maoists are viewed with suspicion, if not hostility. So therefore, you know, everywhere they go, I mean, whether it is, if they go to the police station, if they are at all granted entry, if they, you know, go to any public office. So, you know, this is the general treatment that they get. So even though since 2015, what we have seen in Bastar is that people have started coming out in large numbers. I mean, sometimes in hundreds. You know, when somebody has been picked up like that and they don't know, or, you know, somebody has been fired upon. And there have been many instances, you know, where they have hit out the police station and so on. But then often what happens is that, you know, as soon as it comes to the lodging of the police complaint, you know, demand that an FIR be lodged, often that itself is like as though you're demanding too much, and, you know, often, you know, even that much is not granted. So even in one recent case late last year, there was an instance where 2 youth, Sonku and Bijlu, were killed. Now, Sonku had passed his 8th exam, and, you know, he was now at home, and Bijlu had never gone to school, and he's to help, you know, with his parents, you know, cowherding and so on. So what happens is that Bijlu's sister, Gudiya, she fell ill and died. So the family told Bijlu and Sonku that they should go and inform the Bua, that is auntie, who lived 30 kilometers away. So Sonku and Bijlu leave. They leave at around 3 o'clock in the afternoon, and they reach the aunt's, you know, village. And it's too late now for them to return, so they stay at the aunt's house. So what do we find is that, you know, that night, their hut is surrounded, and, you know, they're picked up. And when the family goes to the police station the next morning, they are told that the dead body has been sent to the police station. So aap soch sakte hain ki kitna shocking hai unke liye. And, you know, on the way, they find that, you know, just across the nala, unke hamlet se thodi dur ek nala hai, nala se just across, they find, you know, evidence, like unke baal and so on. Okay, wahi pe unko mar diya tha. And usi samay, jab Sonku aur Bijlu ki hatya hui, usi samay, you know, I later came across other 2 instances in Sukma district, where they went similarly in one village, picked up a person who was earlier in the Sangam, but had now joined the CPI. He had even attended a meeting that morning and had come home, and he was sleeping in the Angan, and he was picked up. And same thing, like, you know, killed on the way. So this is something, you know, which is the new part of it in recent times that we are seeing, where there is no pretense. Like earlier there was this thing that, you know, usko marenge aur fir, you know, uniform pehnayenge, wo bhi hota hai. But, you know, even this kind of a thing is happening. So in Sukma, in that same week, that was one instance. And in another village not very far away, you know, another instance had happened in a very similar way, where this person, again, who belonged to the Sangam, and he was at home, and there was some festival. He was at, you know, khoob piya tha, and wo so raha tha. Aur usko wahan se hi aangan se utha ke, aur, you know, unko raste mein hi maar diya. And where the family goes, and, you know, police station tak pahunchte hain, aur unko bolte hain ki lash Sukma bhej di gayi hai postmortem ke liye. In the Sonko Bijlu case, what I was trying to actually point out in the context of the FIR was that Mahindra Karma's wife, I mean, you must have heard about Mahindra Karma, the leader of Salvajidum, a Congress leader and the leader of the opposition in the Chhattisgarh Assembly in those days. Now, Mahindra Karma's, after his death and so on, Mahindra Karma's wife, Devti Karma, has become an MLA of that constituency. Now, Devti Karma took up this case. Because abhi increasingly, this is something we are seeing, that the Congress is becoming active. And Devti Karma took up the Sonko Bijlu case. And Devti Karma ko bhi FIR unhone lodge karne ke liye nahi diya. So that time, you know, it became an issue. So hum log ke jaise logon ko to wo immediately dismiss kar dete hain, but you know the fact that somebody like Devti Karma was also, you know, not allowed, and she had to take the family members, she kept them at home, then she was accused of kidnapping them, and then she, you know, lodged the case in the High Court. So, you know, to this extent the state has been going to see to it that even the very first sort of step towards justice is not allowed. Now, when we say Bastar, you know, sometimes we may get an impression that all of Bastar is equally affected. But actually, that is not the case. I mean, as I mentioned to you earlier, the Bastar region, I mean, this was one district when it was in Madhya Pradesh and has since got divided. And in the Bastar region, the war zone is what was earlier the Dantewada district, which is today Bijapur, Dantewada, and Sukma. Narayanpur, of course, you know, where Abujamad is, called Abujamad, I mean, that is known to be the headquarter of the CPI Maoists. So Narayanpur is also another district. And then there is Kanker and then Kondagaon, and then Bastar district itself. Now these are actually, Kanker bhi affected hai, Kondagaon bhi affected hai, but to a less degree. Isme, I think what is important to point out here is that, like in metropolises, like in Jagdalpur, if you see. So if you're living in Jagdalpur, you may actually, you know, you may see the newspaper and you may get to see this kind of news every day. But, you know, your life doesn't get disturbed at all. I mean, you continue to live, and in some ways, there is a kind of a, you know, you're completely divorced from the reality and you can continue to enjoy. Us tarah se ek pura mahol hai. To Jagdalpur mein theaters hain, wahan pe malls hain, you know. So usi tarah se you will see a lot of vehicles, you know, new cars, etc. So including, you know, huge houses. Abhi recently I found in one case, I mean, like real estate is really thriving. So like in one case I found somebody who had got thousands of acres of land. And any sorry, hundreds of dismills of land, or usko unhone usme, you know, bade bade ghar bana ke, like in lakhs, like something like 60 lakhs each, you know, he's selling those. And that is just one instance that I got to know. So is prakar ke bhi kai, you know, businessmen hain jo apna kaam wahan pe, you know, they're completely, you know, in some ways undisturbed, they are continuing their work. So those who are most affected are those who are actually residing in the villages in the war zone, those who are combatants or part of the Maoist organization in any capacity, and of course those who are fighting the state's battle, members of the police force and paramilitary who are mostly from humble backgrounds, so humble that if one family member is killed while on duty, another family member is ready to take the job that is offered in compensation despite the same risks. So the war, like a conveyor belt, you know, keeps rolling. And we are all familiar with the political economy of wars, and know that there are many who gain, who become fat and rich, and cynical on the blood money that they make, and whose interest it is to see that the war continues. After the Salwa Judum, there have been other, you know, vigilante formations. You may have heard about the Salwa, the Samajik Ekta Manch, the Mahila Ekta Manch, and the more recent formation, you know, Agni. Now, what has happened is that actually, unlike the earlier Salwa Judum, what this time round, what they have done is, and which actually they admitted, on camera, and which got them into trouble, and this was a sting operation which happened in April 2016, because of which Samajik Ekta Manch had to disband itself. Where on camera, they said that is bar humne to ye kiya hai ki har jille mein humne is prakar ka group banaya hai, taki if one is banned, then you know the other, we can start operating through the other. Now, there is a difference though between the earlier Salwa Judum and the present day, you know, vigilante groups. And the difference is this, that these are largely unarmed groups, because the government does not really need to in some ways arm them anymore, because the work that the, you know, the earlier, this SPO category, the special police officer category of person who was a local tribal person, who in late 2005 was given the task of assisting the paramilitary that time, you know, given a low wage and a 303 rifle, and who would be both, you know, intelligence worker as well as show them the rasta and also do their dirty work for them. So after the SPOs were banned by the Supreme Court in July 2011, the state got round, you know, that problem by almost immediately, in a matter of few days, you know, forming another group called the Chhattisgarh Auxiliary Force, and they almost took, you know, the entire then SPOs as part of the, they made them CAFs. And since then, they have, you know, they have several, these kind of local district level groups have been formed, like the Koya Commandos, like the DRG, like the District Reserve Guards, which is the most recent one, where, you know, these local tribals are the ones who get recruited. So therefore, that work is now, you know, they can do that legally because they have, you know, they have legal arms and they're part of the force. So this other work that needs to be done, which is, you know, intimidating, you know, gundagardi, ye sab type ka jo pura kaam hai, ye pura kaam ab ye विजिलेंटे ग्रुप्स कर रहे हैं और इनको इम्प्यूनिटी है, इनको खूब मतलब पैसे हैं. आई मीन यू कैन सी देम, यू नो, गोइंग अराउंड जगदलपुर, यू नो, इन फास्ट कार्स एंड थिंग्स लाइक दैट, एंड दे आर वेरी क्लियरली, यू नो, व्हाट आर कॉल्ड पुलिस फ्रेंड्स. सो दे हैव द पैट्रोनाज ऑफ दिस इनफेमस आईजी कलूरी, एंड यू मस्ट हैव ऑल्सो हर्ड that he himself came under a lot of flak and, you know, was moved to Raipur. And we have now another IG. But it's not clear whether on the ground, you know, to what extent will things really change. Bastar has become heavily saffronized. And even on, you know, simple, small, jo har jo bhi Hindu festival hai, jaise abhi Navratra hua ya Ram Navami hua, so everywhere you see these saffron flags, and you see the same guys, you know, who are also part of these vigilante groups. So, you know, you can really very clearly see, you know, how they are now, you know, how Hindutva, how, you know, that is in some ways like a spread of that ideology is happening in a very big way. I mean, there have been instances where Christians have been also attacked, churches have been attacked, and so on. So ye sab bahut tarah tarah ke, you know, problems hai. In the press there has been a lot of coverage of how political workers, how some professionals, you know, be they in the in the category of journalists or you know, writers, lawyers, you know, how they have been targeted. I think all of you may know of that. So there has been a, you know, a silencing that has been going on, and there has been like a shrinkage of democratic space. To the extent that very recently, you may have also read about that, the, you know, SP of Sukma, he, in a meeting which he attended along with Mr. Kaluri, even though Kaluri had been moved to Raipur, but with SP of Bastar, another notorious officer called Mr. Dash, and Kaluri himself, and you know, the SP, this SP of Sukma, Mr. Elsella, who is a JNU product. So they openly said, you know, that नहीं मैंने JNU इसलिए कहा क्योंकि बस्तर में JNU का भी मतलब जगदलपुर में JNU का भी एफिजी हैज बीन बर्न्ड. So that way I'm saying कि हम मैं भी जब उनको मिली थी तो मैं उनको कह रही थी कि आप भी JNU ही है. So anyway, so तो वो तो खुला बोल रहे थे, you know, वो तो ऐसा बोल रहे थे कि you know, human rights workers, उनको तो मोटर के नीचे you know, कुचल देना चाहिए. They were inaugurating a private function and उसमें मतलब इस तरह से खुला बोल रहे थे. एंड जगदलपुर लीगल एड ग्रुप के दो लॉयर्स, ईशा खंडेलवाल और शालिनी गेरा का नाम लेकर भी उन्होंने ऐसे कहा, एंड ऑल्सो इंक्लूडिंग अदर यू नो ह्यूमन राइट्स वर्कर्स इन जनरल. सो देर इज़ अ काइंड ऑफ अ वेरी ओपन काइंड ऑफ यू नो टारगेटिंग दैट इज गोइंग ऑन. वॉट इज वरिंग इन दिस होल थिंग इज द एक्सटेंट टू विच यू नो वो लोग हम लोगों की इमेज बस्तर सोसाइटी में धूमिल करते हैं. आई थिंक दैट इज़ द वरिंग थिंग वेन यू नो अदर मेम्बर्स ऑफ द सोसाइटी ऑल्सो स्टार्ट थिंकिंग ऑफ अस इन पर्टिकुलर वेज. एंड दैट इज़ वॉट मेक्स मी फील वेरी वेरी स्ट्रांगली दैट यू नो एंड एस्पेशली बिकॉज ऑफ दिस होल एक्सपेंशन ऑफ द सैफरन ब्रिगेड. एंड भविष्य में आई थिंक और भी बहुत कुछ होगा वहाँ पर. आई रियली फील दैट वी नीड टू यू नो have direct conversation and find ways of doing that with the very ordinary people, you know, in the towns, in the villages of Bastar. हम लोग को अपनी बात उनके सामने directly, you know, रखनी है, उनको directly हमको बताना है. अक्सर क्या होता है कि हम लोग की भी गलतियाँ हैं, हम लोग अक्सर आपस में ही रह जाते हैं, you know, हम लोग, there's so much of activism now happening on the social media, for that matter, you know. So and of course that, you know, we mostly remain within ourselves. We are communicating to each other. So often we are not communicating with, you know, those जिनके साथ में हमारा एक dialogue होना चाहिए. You know, हमारी जनता के साथ में, हमारे लोगों के साथ में. हो सकता है वो हमारी बात नहीं समझे, हो सकता है वो हमारा विरोध कर रहे हैं, you know, जो भी है, मगर we need to build that dialogue. And what is happening is that because we are not there, I mean, there are other people who are, you know, occupying that space. So therefore, I feel that in a very big way, I think this challenge, I think we have to take up now. I think not only in Bastar, but in other parts as well, which is about, I mean, now we have to, I mean, the goal of making our democracy a sort of real democracy, radical democracy, I mean, all that remains. But even, you know, just the very basic fundamentals of democracy, I mean, now we have to really fight for that, that even that this should not be taken away from us. So if we think that this is a goal and this is something to strive for, then I think we have to also, you know, open ourselves up to looking at things, to seeing things from the other person's point of view. How are they seeing things? How are they understanding things? Because the way we see things is the source of the way we think and the way we act. Where we stand depends on where we sit, somebody said. This point has been made by a few authors, including Anatole Rapoport and others. Y'all may have come across an, you know, image which has circulated sometimes in some books, where there's this image of, you know, the same image could be seen, like you may see a young woman in it and you may also see an older woman. I had actually made a printout, somehow it's got left behind. So that's quite a telling image, because you have to look very hard. Often what happens is, at the very first instance, you may either see the outline of the young woman, you know, she's very aristocratic with a nice some band or something. And actually, if you strain and you look, you can see the hooked nose of the older woman. And, you know, the image could also be of an older woman. And that is just an illustration to see that, you know, often, you know, the same ground reality, you know, could be viewed, you know, differently by different people. So two people may be seeing the same thing, you know, they may even disagree, and yet both may be right. Now in Bastar, there are not actually just two sides to the conflict. You know, it's not just the state and the Maoists. In that state category, of course, we can include, you know, the policymakers, the police and paramilitary, the ineffectual governor, the MLAs and the MPs, and of course, the corporates. I mean, they are in a completely close nexus. In the Maoist category, you know, you may include the leaders, the cadres, and villagers who are actively part of the movement, you know, as Jan Militia, or, you know, as Sangha members, and so on. Then there is a third category of people who may be living in the Maoist areas, have some association, but not be active supporters or, you know, opponents. There's a fourth category of people who have disagreed with the Maoists and have had to move out voluntarily or involuntarily, many of whom may have been directly targeted. For example, families of those who have been accused as police informers. There have been targeting of Christian pastors and so on. This category may also include those who want development. So this may include teachers, this may include contractors, shopkeepers, etc. There's a fifth category, you know, of opponents, very clearly opponents, who are often very clear, you know, they are business-minded people who stand to gain by siding with the establishment. Often you see, and you may find, that some of them were earlier with the Maoists also. And then when the Salvage Room started, you know, so they switched sides. Jab unko pata chala ki isme khub paisa hai. Or is opponent category mein, you will also find, you know, victims of Maoist violence who have become active opponents. So there are some who have not become active opponents, but there are some who have become active opponents. So for example, Farooq Ali, who is a leader of Agni in Sukma, so Farooq Ali ke bhai Sattar Ali was attacked. So is tarah ke kai jagah mein, local level mein, you will find these, you know, old histories and so on. Then there's a sixth category, like a civil society of, you know, of basically including a civil society that is largely ineffectual in Bastar. And then, of course, there are the other non-Maoist, non-ruling party political actors, like the CPI, now the Congress is getting active, tribal activists, and so on. Now, we who may be middle-class intellectuals, activists, journalists, have tended by and large not to engage with the other side. We have therefore not been able to understand or appreciate enough the felt reality from the perspective of the others. This non-engagement on our part has become a cause of suspicion and hostility of the outsider. And here I would like to point out that, you know, every time the vigilante groups have, and members of the vigilante groups, you know, have questioned, at least in my experience, each time it has been, the question has been, why don't you, you know, raise your voice when the same thing, jab Maoist violence mein, aap kyun nahi uthate hain prashna? Ye ek baar nahi, baar baar hota hai. Wo aapke saamne aapko instance laake dikhate hain. Aapko photo dikhate hain. You know, ek IED blast victim ka, ya is tarah ke kai instances hain. Aur wo aapse ye jawab poochte hain. At least mere saath to aisa nahi hua hai ki they have said, you know, ki why are you raising questions related to mining or the forest or so on. It is always the Maoist violence question, you know, that they ask. So somewhere I do feel that, you know, this, and this is something that I'm going to talk about right now. And I'm going to talk about it because this is not talked about. There is a certain kind of a silence, you know, around this whole question. There is a war going on. You know, there is, you know, violence also from the Maoist side. And that violence also has consequences. So somewhere we do need to also look squarely into that and, you know, think about it. When we engage, we find that there are indeed many persons who have been wronged, who may often not know that many, we may often not know that many who are opponents of the Maoists, you know, active or otherwise, were once, you know, part of the movement, that there are many unnecessary deaths, and that, you know, the Maoists often kill in a very brutal manner. So for example, and there are a few examples of this kind that I'd like to give you from, you know, the during my years over the last decade, like, you know, when I've been going from time to time for my research and human rights work. So in 2007, 2008, for example, when I was trying to understand the Salwa Jadum, and I was trying to talk to people who had run away on that side, on the Khammam side, because that time it was impossible to go into the region and actually talk to people there. So us samay wo log mirchi baadi mein kaam kar rahe the, to mirchi baadi mein ek mirchi baadi se dusri mirchi baadi mujhe main ja rahi thi to figure out ki kya hua. Usi doran main us side se, I mean you can go from that, from the Hyderabad side, I went from the Bhadrachalam side, I went to Bhopalpatnam, that is one of the tehsils of Bijapur district. Now in Bhopalpatnam I found, like, in one school I found some children. So I, you know, was talking to those kids. So there was this child who was describing ki kis tarah se wo raat mein aaye, mere pitaji ko pakde, unka, you know, haath piche bande, fir unko maar maar ke lekar gaye, fir usko wahan lekar gaye, fir usko maar diye. So I was of course thinking, Salwa Jadum ne kiya, like that. But no, I was surprised to hear that actually they were, the child was speaking about the Maoist. Similarly, in 2008, in Kutru, in Bijapur, I came across a girl who had become an Anganwadi teacher. She told me a story, and again, she was, that whole region was very much part of the movement. वहीं से डिसेंट शुरू हुआ था जो एक तरह से स्टेट ने पूरी तरह से यूज़ किया सरकार वेदर इट बी द स्टेट और द यूनियन गवर्नमेंट्स दे यूज्ड इट एंड मेड इट इनटू अ बिग ऑपरेशन बट शुरू में जो इंस्टेंस हुआ था वो था डिसएग्रीमेंट का और डिसेंट का तो उस इंस्टेंसेस पे मैं नहीं जा रही हूँ बट जस्ट टू मैंशन दिस वन पर्टिकुलर एग्जाम्पल एज अ फॉलो आउट उस पूरे समय का जिसमें दिस गर्ल अ यंग गर्ल डिस्क्राइब्स अबाउट हाउ यू नो इट्स नाइट She and her other family members are inside the house, and on the veranda her father and her brother are sleeping, and like father kuch upar mein nahi pehne the aur kis tarah se wo log aaye maawadi aaye and you know wo kulhari se unke pitaji ko maarne ke liye aaye aur kis tarah se wo keh rahi thi ki main unko chilla ke keh rahi thi dada mat maro and you know wo कुल्हार वो ऐसे करके थे कोने में दुबके हुए थे और उन्होंने उनके पिताजी को भी मार दिया और उनका जो भाई जो ग्रोन अप सन जो वहाँ पे कोर्ट में लेटा हुआ था उसको भी मार दिया इन 2008 यू मे हैव हर्ड व्हेन द वनवासी चेतना आश्रम लेड बाय हिमांशु कुमार दे वर ट्राइंग टू रीसेटल सम पीपल सो द रीसेटलमेंट प्रोसेस हैड स्टार्टेड उस समय कोपा कुंजाम उनका एक एक्टिविस्ट वो चावल लेकर बासागुड़ा गया था उन दिनों में कोई ट्रांसपोर्ट ही नहीं हुआ करता था सो अराउंड 20 or so पीपल टुक अ लिफ्ट यू नो व्हेन द ट्रक वाज कमिंग बैक एंड कोपा हिमसेल्फ वाज ऑन द मोटरसाइकिल सो टू पीपल आल्सो टुक अ लिफ्ट फ्रॉम हिम सो दे वाज स्टॉप्ड ऑन द वे एंड देन अ पीडीएस डीलर एंड अ दलित फ्रॉम अ नियर बाय विलेज एंड the another chap, an older chap, they were pulled out and unko अंदर ले गए, जंगल में ले गए. उसके बाद हिमांशु एंड दिस वन कोपा वो लोग वापस आए एंड उनको घेराव किए, मतलब कैंप में वहाँ पे घेराव किए कि तुम लोग के ही गाड़ी में हमारा आदमी चला गया एंड सो ऑन. सो दे हैव टू देन फ्रॉम दैट रूट दे हैव टू जस्ट गो फर्दर अप टू भद्राचलम. दे कुड नॉट इवन रिटर्न. एंड दैट टाइम आई वॉज इन द रीजन एंड समबडी नीडेड टू गो फ्रॉम विलेज टू विलेज ऑफ दैट एरिया टू ट्राई टू से कि उनको छोड़ दो. हाँ, और उनको क्यों छोड़ दो, मतलब आर्ग्यूमेंट हम लोग उसमें यही कह रहे थे कि आप उनको छोड़ दीजिए कि देखिए मतलब ये तो पूरा वनवासी चेतना आश्रम का मतलब पूरा काम भी रुक जाएगा और ये तो उनके साथ में थे एंड सो ऑन, विच इज़ अ कम्प्लीटली यू नो ये तो कोई आर्ग्यूमेंट नहीं है. मतलब मैं तो डेथ पेनाल्टी के खिलाफ हूँ, चाहे वो किसका भी डेथ हो, तो मेरे लिए तो वो उस तरह से कोई आर्ग्यूमेंट नहीं है. मगर फिर भी हम यही बोल रहे थे. कई गाँव में गए, कई जगह ये बात भी कही, वहाँ 3-4 दिन रही, मगर यू नो आफ्टर 3-4 डेज अ डेड बॉडी वॉज फाउंड नियर द स्कूल. सो दिस वॉज अ डेड बॉडी ऑफ द दिस अदर चैप, द ओल्डर चैप. द PDS डीलर वॉज लेफ्ट स्कॉट फ्री, आई मीन लेफ्ट विद अ वार्निंग बिकॉज हिज ब्रदर वॉज इन SPO इन बीजापुर. सो हिज थिंग वॉज कि तुम अपने भाई को बोलो वो SPO छोड़े, नहीं तो यू नो मारेंगे. और इस व्यक्ति को उन्होंने मार दिया. तो इस व्यक्ति का क्या गुना था, तो वो एक सरपंच था, क्योंकि मैनी सरपंचेज हैव बीन टारगेटेड इन द एरिया एंड आई ऑल्सो यू नो इंटरव्यूड वन ऑफ द फर्स्ट जो 7 लोग गए थे उस रीजन में और जिनका साफ ये कहना था कि मतलब सरपंच तो यू नो लोएस्ट लेवल है पूरी सरकार का, यू नो. सो दिस काइंड ऑफ टारगेटिंग सरपंचेज का तो वो लोग किए हैं. तो उसका गुना ये था कि वो एक तो सरपंच था पहले, और दूसरा उसका गुना ये था कि वो BJP में था, तीसरा उसका गुना ये था कि जब सर्वाजुडुम ने उस एरिया में मीटिंग्स किए थे तो उसने सर्वाजुडुम के मंच से वो बोला था. नॉ नन ऑफ दीज इन अ डेमोक्रेटिक सोसाइटी यू नो अलाउज यू टू किल द पर्सन. इन नारायणपुर इन 2009 दे केम टू समबडीज हाउस इन द नाइट. They were after the PDS dealer. The husband was a PDS dealer. PDS dealer meaning PDS shopkeeper. It said that he was a corrupt person. So they wanted to get him. They could not find him. So they took his wife, who was an Anganwadi teacher. And 4 days later, the body of the Anganwadi teacher was found on the road. You know, usko maar ke unhone pheka hua tha. 2013 में जब महेंद्र कर्मा की घटना घटी, जब महेंद्र कर्मा को मारा गया उसी तारीख, इट वॉज द सेम डेट एंड अलॉन्ग विद द ह्यूमन राइट्स फोरम वी वर जस्ट रिटर्निंग फ्रॉम अ फैक्ट फाइंडिंग इन एड्समेटा. सो इन एड्समेटा द पीपल हैड बीन सेलिब्रेटिंग अ बीजा पांडुम लाइक अ सीट फेस्टिवल एंड दे हैड बीन सराउंडेड बाय द सिक्योरिटी फोर्सेज एंड दे हैड बीन किल्ड 8 पीपल इंक्लूडिंग 4 चिल्ड्रन. सो वी हैड गॉन ऑन अ फैक्ट फाइंडिंग एंड आफ्टर दैट I had gone to lodge a police complaint on that in the police station. While returning, because suddenly one found that there was no private transport available, मतलब वहाँ सरकारी ट्रांसपोर्ट तो है ही नहीं, पैसेंजर जीप्स चलते हैं, तो सब कुछ बंद था. तो क्या हुआ, तब मुझे पता चला कि वो दरबा में वो घटना घटी है और महेंद्र कर्मा मारे गए हैं. सो देर वॉज नो अदर ऑल्टरनेटिव, वन हैड टू वॉक. सो चल के गए एंड उस रात को by that time the team had to go, so I was alone that time. So उस रात को रास्ते में ही एक चेरपाल, मतलब बहुत आगे रास्ते में nearer, closer to बीजापुर is a place called चेरपाल. So वहाँ पर एक कैंप है, सलाजीडूम का कैंप है. I had no alternative, so I went and to the सरपंच and I said कि I would like to stay here tonight. So they asked me कि कहाँ से आए हो. So then I said मैं कहाँ से आई हूँ, because आप उस एरिया में जब घूमते हैं तो आपको आप देर इज़ नो पॉइंट इन यू नो आप झूठ फूट कुछ बोलने की ज़रूरत नहीं है, क्योंकि सब कुछ वहाँ पे खुला है, सब कुछ सबको पता ही चलेगा. तो मैंने बोला हाँ मैं एड्समेटा गई थी. सी व्हाट आई एम ट्राइंग टू से इज दैट आई एम इन द सर्वाजुडुम कैंप, ओके, एंड दिस इज 2013. महेंद्र कर्मा हैज़ बीन किल्ड. यू कैन इमेजिन द एंगर दैट वन वुड एक्सपेक्ट, कि एंगर तो बहुत रहेगा. सो द सरपंच सेज ठीक है आप इधर रह जाइए. नाउ टू माई माइंड आई थॉट बहुत गुस्सा होगा सब में, बट वॉट डू आई सी, उस समय क्रिकेट का कुछ बहुत बड़ा मैच चल रहा था, उनके वहाँ पे TV था, तो मुझे वो बोले कि आपको न्यूज़ देखना होगा ना, वो उसके घटना का न्यूज़ देखना होगा, अभी दिखाते हैं. सो वो टीवी देख रहे थे, बीच बीच में वो मुझे न्यूज़ दिखाते थे, देन अगेन दे वुड गो बैक टू द क्रिकेट मैच. नाउ आई फाउंड दैट क्वाइट इंटरेस्टिंग, यू नो दैट देर आर, यू नो इट्स नॉट लाइक दैट काइंड ऑफ ब्लैक एंड वाइट काइंड ऑफ अ सीन. एंड इट इज़ इंटरेस्टिंग, लाइक दे सेड कि तुम कहाँ से आई, देन आई सेड इट इज़ मिट्टा, देन दे सेड कि अच्छा डिड यू आस्क द पुलिस, बिकॉज आई सेड आई गॉट टू द पुलिस स्टेशन, सो देन दे सेड डिड यू आस्क देम फॉर द पोस्टमार्टम ऑफ द मैन हु डाइड, जो मारा गया, बिकॉज 8 लोग मरे गए, एक पुलिस मैन मारा गया था, एंड द पुलिस वॉज एक्यूजिंग दैट वो बुलेट माओइस्ट के द्वारा चला है, जबकि लोग बोल रहे थे कि वहाँ माओइस्ट नहीं थे. सो देयर इज दिस पर्सन इन द यू नो सर्वाजीडम कैंप यूथ हु इज टेलिंग मी कि डिड यू आस्क दैट, एंड यू शुड हैव आस्क दैट बिकॉज देन यू वुड नो द ट्रूथ, एंड द ट्रूथ वॉज दैट वहाँ पे कोई यू नो माओइस्ट नहीं थे उस दिन. और वो सरपंच भी बोल रहा था कि मेरा खुद का भाई वो बीजापुर में डीएफ है, एंड वो भी वहाँ था, वो भी हमको बता रहा था कि ये तो वो ही लोग किए हैं. हाँ, सो दिस इज द सरपंच हु इज टेलिंग मी, एंड देन ऑफकोर्स वेन वी गॉट टॉकिंग ही सेड दैट ही वॉज अर्लियर इन द माओइस्ट विद द माओइस्ट, एंड ही सेड अ यंग फेलो एक्चुअली अ यंग आदिवासी एंड वेरी जेंटल, लाइक काफ़ी सामान्य इससे बात कर रहे थे, एंड देन ही सेज दैट मैं भी उनके साथ था एंड मैं तो उनका पूरा हथियार रखता था, यू नो मेरा घर नदी के पास था, दे वुड कीप ऑल देयर हथियार इन माय हाउस एंड देन क्रॉस द रिवर, एंड ही सेड मगर उन्होंने मेरे फादर पिताजी को उन्होंने मार दिया, और ये कहकर मार दिया कि वो मतलब उनके खिलाफ हैं. तो ही वॉज सेइंग कि मेरे पिताजी उनके खिलाफ कैसे हो सकते थे, उनके परमिशन के बिना तो मैं भी हथियार नहीं रख पाता. सो on that instance, for example, I mean, he related that instance, maybe there was more, maybe there was less, I don't know, but he said because of that he left them, and then when Sarvajidum arrived on the scene, then he joined them. Police informers ke to bahut ghatnaye hain aur anek ghatnaye bar bar hoti rehti hain. इसमें कई बार मतलब आपको सुनने में मिलता है, जैसे अभी एक दरबा में 2015 में वी वर एक्चुअली इन्वेस्टिगेटिंग इनटू अनदर इंस्टेंस, ऑल ऑफ अस वर देयर, सोनी हम लोग सब थे, एंड इट वाज पूरे लोगों ने घेराव किया हुआ था एंड ऑल दैट वहाँ पे पुलिस स्टेशन, एंड हम लोगों को फिर उस समय पता चला कि अभी हाल में ही तो पांडू को मारा, यू नो पांडू वो पास के एक गाँव का था, उसको पुलिस इन्फॉर्मर करके मार दिया था, एंड ही वॉज एन ओल्डर मैन highly respected in the area, and they all said Pandu to bahut acha aadmi tha, we used to all go, kabhi bhi humko zarurat hota tha Pandu ko jaake hum milte the. Usi tarah hal mein in 2016, this again I got to know from Linga and Soni, so now they are friends, so you know they also know them, jaise ye ek vyakti somebody called Harish in from a village called Potali in Dantewada, to Harish aur Linga apparently saath saath bade bhi hue hain, to ye to mujhe kahani unse hi pata chala hai ki usko bhi police informer keh ke usko maar diya, और मारने के तरीके में उसको उसकी माँ के सामने माँ भी थी उसकी माँ के सामने मारा, पूरा एक रस्सी बड़ा रस्सी लेकर एक इस साइड से खींच रहा है एक इस साइड से खींच रहा है एंड सो ऑन. सो ऑफ कोर्स इसमें फिर किसी से मैं बात कर रही थी तो कोई बोला था कि नहीं नहीं माँ के सामने नहीं मारना था, नहीं नहीं इस तरह से नहीं मारना था. सो दे कैन बी वेरियस डिग्रीज, आई मीन दे में से कि हाँ मारना था मगर इस तरह से नहीं मारना था, यू नो ऐसा है. तो खैर हरीश का हत्या इस तरह से हुआ, उसी तरह वहीं पे एक सुजीत करके थे, वो फुलपाट के थे, वो भी इनके जानकार व्यक्ति थे, उसको भी मारा. अभी हाल में 2016 में मैं अभी खम्मम के बॉर्डर एरिया में गई थी और वहाँ पे एक पास्टर मारैया करके उसको मारा, और एक्चुअली दे हैड नॉट कम फॉर मारैया, दे हैड कम फॉर हिज ब्रदर एंड हु हैड एक्चुअली हु वॉज फ्रॉम अ सुकमा विलेज एरिया, ही हैड कन्वर्टेड टू, ही वॉज अ वड्डे, वड्डे मीनिंग आदिवासी पुरोहित, एंड वो कन्वर्ट किए थे, फिर उसको टारगेट कर रहे थे, बाइबल वो सब भी बंद किए थे, फिर वहाँ से वो भागकर वो इधर आए थे, एंड उसका जो दैट फेलो आई हैड इंटरव्यूड मेनी इयर्स अगो इन 2008 or 2009, सो आई वेंट देयर बिकॉज आई हर्ड दैट अ पास्टर हैज़ बीन किल्ड, सो आई थॉट ओ इट कुड बी द सेम पास्टर, सो देयरफॉर आई वेंट, एंड व्हाट आई हियर एक्चुअली वाज दैट सेम पास्टर वॉज नॉट, एंड ही हैड गॉन अंडरग्राउंड, देन लेटर हिज सन टुक मी to the village where he was now sheltering in Khammam. But then what I discover is that his brother was killed instead. Maraya was killed because they could not find this guy. ये बर्थडे के ही बात में जैसे इस तरह के आप लोगों को मिलते हैं तो ही आप बातों को थोड़ा समझ सकते हैं और आप बातों को मानते हैं, बिकॉज अदरवाइज इट मे इवन सीम लाइक प्रोपेगेंडा. सो जैसे मैं जिस गांव में रह रही थी, परपा नाम का गांव, जहां से मैं अभी नहीं रह रही हूं, मुझे वहां से जाना पड़ा है, मैं अब जगदलपुर में हूं, पर परपा के पास एक गांव है सरगीपाल. तो परपा में एक बार मेरी एक नेबर वो बीमार पड़ गई. सो आई हैव अ टीवीएस, सो आई ऑफर टू टेक हर टू द हॉस्पिटल. सो आई वॉज गोइंग टू हेड टू जगदलपुर टू महारानी हॉस्पिटल. सो शी सेड नहीं नहीं आप वहाँ मत जाइए, आप मुझे सरगीपाल ले जाइए. हाँ, सो सरगीपाल में वहाँ बहुत एक अच्छा डॉक्टर है. सो आई वेंट टू सरगीपाल. सो सरगीपाल में आई मेट दिस स्लाइट पर्सन, वेरी स्लिम, वेरी जेंटल टाइप ऑफ पर्सन, हु वॉज अ क्रिश्चियन एंड हु ट्रीटेड हर. देन वी गॉट टॉकिंग, आई मीन आई अज्यूम ही वॉज फ्रॉम सरगीपाल, बट देन वी गॉट टॉकिंग एंड आई हियर दैट ही वॉज एक्चुअली फ्रॉम अ विलेज कॉल कोलिंग. एंड कोलिंग ये दरबा का गाँव है, अंदर का गाँव है. वो जो पांडू था वो कोलिंग का ही था. And then he says that he was a vadde. Vadde मतलब again मतलब वो tribal जो है. And वो सबको treat करता था, आदिवासी medicine. So then he said कि मैं तो vadde था. And then मेरा बेटा बीमार पड़ा, 3 साल या 4 साल का बच्चा बीमार पड़ा. And he was almost dying. And we had lost all hope. And then he said somebody who was a Christian, who had, you know, वो Christian बन गए थे. And उन्होंने उनको बोला कि तुम्हारा क्या जाता है, एज अ लास्ट दिस थिंग तुम इसको ट्राई करो, यू नो. तो ही सेड कि ठीक है, मैं उसके साथ गया अपने बच्चे को. एंड देन यू नो उसके बॉडी में रख के ईसु का नाम लेके वटे वटे वटे. एंड ही सेड कि 3 दिन में मेरा बच्चा ठीक हो गया. तो मुझे लगा कि नहीं, इसमें तो कुछ है, कुछ बात है. सो ही सेड देयरफॉर आई डिसाइडेड टू कन्वर्ट, क्योंकि कुछ शक्ति मुझे लगा है, इसलिए मेरा बेटा ठीक हुआ. सो देयरफॉर ही चेंज ही यू नो बिकेम he converted and he became a Christian. And he continued to stay in the village. But then there was pressure because the people whom he used to serve, they were asking him to continue that medicine. So he said ki main isai ban gaya hu. Now I am not in a position to also be a vadde, you know. So main nahi kar sakta. So but they wouldn't leave him alone. Phir प्रेशर बनता रहा, फिर उसका किसी रिलेटिव को, देयर वाज सम वायलेंस ऑन सम रिलेटिव एंड सो ऑन. एंड देन ही लेफ्ट दैट प्लेस, ही स्टार्टेड लिविंग इन दरबा टाउन. देन आफ्टर दैट इवेंचुअली ही लेफ्ट दरबा एंड ही केम टू सरगीपाल. वहाँ पे उन्होंने थोड़ा एक जमीन खरीदा है, वहाँ अपना घर बनाया है और अभी वो वहाँ पे रह रहे हैं. सो देयरफॉर थ्रू ऑल दिस काइंड ऑफ स्टोरीज, and of course there are more, and there are more stories from both sides, as I said. I mean, there's a lot of violence going on. So the most important point here, which I would like to, because see, whenever hum jab bhi Maoist violence ki baat karte hain, so the argument immediately is about structural violence, no? So, you know, and that therefore, you know, makes it, you know, legitimate ki haan, hathyar to uthana pad, matlab at least jo log usme mante hain, main nahi manti hu, magar there is a political line. And, you know, there is a political thought, you know, behind this. So the argument always is about, you know, structural violence, and rightly so, you know, there's no doubt about it. Ki bahut bhayanak hai sthiti. Magar point mere man mein ye hai, aur ye main khulli charcha aapke saath kar rahi hoon. Matlab, I would like to also hear what others have to say. But mujhe aisa lagta hai ki irrespective of the cause, as reason for taking up arms, you know, there are also always consequences of the violence, you know, for which there is no preparedness in the theory. So only up to a point, you know, the theory goes. Uske baad koi kuch shunya hai. Now those whose family members have been killed by the Maoists, you know, do we really expect them, you know, not to do anything? You know, out of powerlessness, maybe they may not do anything, maybe they may, because again, I know often these are Adivasis. You know, जैसे अगर हम उनको अगर नॉन आदिवासी बोल दें, कॉन्ट्रैक्टर बोल दें, ट्रेडर बोल दें, यू नो रियल एस्टेट बिजनेसमैन बोल दें, सो देन समवेयर एवरीथिंग इन आवर माइंड गेट्स जस्टिफाइड कि अरे ये बड़ा आदमी है या जो भी है. मगर अक्सर क्या ये भी देखने को मिलता है कि कई बार वो ऑर्डिनरी आदिवासी ही है, पर उसको भी अपना जंगल छोड़ना पड़ा है, अपना जमीन छोड़ना पड़ा है, यू नो. तो फिर हम ये भी बात कर सकते हैं कि जब हम सबके आदिवासी के हक की बात करते हैं, जंगल की जमीन सबके लिए बात करते हैं, तो फिर सबका मगर ऐसे बहुत डिस्प्लेस्ड लोग हैं. और मैं ये भी कहूँगी कि ऐसे डिस्प्लेस्ड लोग, और मैंने ये मेरी रिसर्च में पाया है कि ये सर्वाजड़ुम के पहले भी वहाँ पे इस प्रकार के डिस्प्लेस्ड लोग थे और है, मतलब उनसे मैंने मेरे रिसर्च में मेरी बातचीत रही है. Some Salvajadum members, when I was interviewing them in, you know, that time, I remember 2007-8 and so on. That time I remember, उनमें से एक जन मुझे पूछा था कि आप लोग ये क्यों भूल जाते हो कि हम लोग किसका oppose कर रहे हैं, कि जो एक armed movement है हम उसका oppose कर रहे हैं. हम लोग targeted हैं क्योंकि हम अगर जैसे अभी इनके केस में उनको लगता है कि ये revolutionary वाले politics से नहीं होगा, हम लोग विकास वाली रेगुलर धारा में हम जाना चाहते हैं. और ये लोग भी ऑर्डिनरी लोग ही हैं वहीं के. तो जब हम उनका विरोध कर रहे हैं और हम पुलिस के पास जाते हैं प्रोटेक्शन के लिए, तो हम क्या गलती करते हैं? तो इमीडिएटली आप लोग हम लोग पर लपक पड़ते हो. द पुलिस हैज ऑफकोर्स यूज सच पर्सन्स, sometimes entire communities, you know, to their advantage. क्योंकि they are like sitting ducks ना, जो लोग भाग कर आए हुए हैं उनके टारगेट में हैं, पुलिस के प्रोटेक्शन में हैं. और आज आप बीजापुर जाएंगे तो आपको जगदलपुर में शायद ऐसे लोग नहीं भी मिलेंगे, कम मिलेंगे, मगर आपको बीजापुर में बहुत मिल जाएंगे. आपको नारायणपुर में भी हेमलेट मिल जाएगा, ऐसे कई एरियाज में आपको बहुत लोग ऐसे मिलेंगे. और उस तरह के जो लोग हैं, जो जिनको सरकार से कुछ कॉम्पेंसेशन भी मिला होगा, क्योंकि अक्सर हम लोगों का ये आर्ग्यूमेंट रहता है कि देखिए आप लोगों को तो फिर भी सरकार देख लेती है, जो दूसरे स्टेट वायलेंस के लोग हैं उनको कोई नहीं देखता है. सो देयरफॉर वी, यू नो, हम लोग, हमारे पास में भी कम, हम लोग कम लोग हैं तो फिर हम उस पर टाइम देते हैं. ऑफन दैट, यू नो, दैट आर्ग्यूमेंट वी यूज़ एंड ऑफन आई हैव ऑल्सो यूज दैट, बट दैट आर्ग्यूमेंट डजंट होल्ड फॉर टू लॉन्ग इफ यू आर लिविंग इन दैट एरिया, यू नो, ऑल द टाइम. And what happens is, and this has happened, you know, to me, my colleagues, you know, when we were working, it has happened that you know, वो लोग आए हैं हमारे पास में, and you know, हमको सामने से उन्होंने प्रश्न किया है कि आप आए हो, आप ये सवाल उठा रहे हो, पर आप हम लोग का सवाल नहीं उठा रहे हो. अक्सर ऐसा भी हुआ है, और ये जब रेप केसेस के समय में भी जब हम बीजापुर में थे ऐसा हुआ था वहाँ के. ये संभव है कि पुलिस ने ही उनको जानकारी दी, ये महिला लोग इधर आई है, वो महिलाओं को अंदर गांव से लेके आई है, NHRC आई हुई थी, तो वी वट, यू नो, इन डायलॉग विद NHRC एंड सो ऑन. जानकारी उनको पुलिस से ही मिला होगा, मगर वो लोग आके वो लोग बाहर में नारे दे रहे थे. और उस समय वो लोग, हम लोग टीम में 3 महिलाएं थी, दे डिड नॉट नो द अदर्स अर्लियर, सो परहैप्स दैट इज़ वाई दे वर ओनली मेरा नाम लेके बोल रहे थे. मगर वो लोग वही बोल रहे थे कि तुम समर्थक हो, तुम मेरा नाम लेके बोल रहे थे, तुम नक्सली समर्थक हो, मतलब ऐसा नारा दे रहे थे. तो वो लोग बाहर में ही बहुत देर तक नारे देते रहे. नारा देना डेमोक्रेटिक एक्ट है, डेमोन्स्ट्रेशन इज़ अ, यू नो, चाहे वो कोई भी करे. It may, you may not like it, but that is their right. So, वो लोग दे रहे थे. मगर स्थिति ऐसी थी कि ऐसा लगा कि हम लोग बाहर निकलेंगे तो पता नहीं हम सेफ रहे नहीं हैं. So that time the collector and all these people were also there, NHRC was there. So the collector offered कि हाँ, हम हमारे व्हीकल में आपको छोड़ देंगे जहाँ भी आपको जाना है. उसके पहले रात हम लोग वहाँ पर ही ट्रेनिंग सेंटर में रहे थे, आदिवासी ट्रेनिंग सेंटर, एंड दैट हैड अ बिग, यू नो, बिग आयरन डोर. एंड सो इनिशियली हम तो वही सोच रहे थे वहीं चले जाते हैं, यू नो, दरवाज़ा बंद, यू नो, इट्स अ सेफ साउंड इनफ प्लेस. बट इट्स इंटरेस्टिंग दैट इन आर टीम, लाइक, यू नो, वी वर कॉन्फरिंग वॉट शुड वी डू, एंड इट वॉज फेल्ट दैट नो, वी मे नॉट बी सेफ देयर. सो वॉट डू वी डू? सो लेट्स, यू नो, वील गो एंड सिट इन द SP ऑफिस. सो वी वेंट टू द SP ऑफिस एंड वी सैट देयर. वी वेटेड फॉर द फ्यू आवर्स दैट वी हैड टू वेट, यू नो, अंटिल आवर अस इन द SP ऑफिस. सो इवन वी वेंट, you know, because a mob, and this mob was an unarmed mob, you know, they were shouting slogans only. They did not have any danda in their hand, they did not even have any banner in their hand. Magar hum log dare the, matlab hum मैं अपने मैं भी टीम में थी तो मैं जरूर यू नो मैं सबके लिए मतलब अपने को भी गिनूंगी आई मीन आई फेल्ट स्लाइटली डिफरेंटली देन अदर्स बट नेवर माइंड वी वर पार्ट ऑफ द सेम टीम एंड द डिसीजन वाज टेकन टुगेदर बट दिस इज व्हाट हैपेंस सो व्हाट डू वी गो टू द एसपी ऑफिस एंड दैट टाइम इनफैक्ट आई पॉइंटेड इट आउट टू माय अदर टीम मेंबर्स आल्सो कि दिस इज व्हाट हैपेंस व्हेन दे गो एंड अगर उनके सामने में एक आर्म्ड मॉब है हो सकता है वो आर्म्ड मॉब यू नो क्रांतिकारी हो उसका कोई भी पार्टी हो उसका कुछ भी हो मगर वो अगर आपके सामने में यू नो एक एग्रेसर बन के आया है आपको आपको वो मार सकता है आपकी हत्या कर सकता है आपका घर जला सकता है तो आप यू नो अपने बचाव के लिए आप कहाँ जाएंगे और आपके पास हथियार नहीं है आप कहाँ जाएंगे तो आप किसके पास जाएंगे आप पुलिस के पास जाएंगे ठीक है तो उसी दिन हम लोग भी वही किए मतलब हम आपको यही बता रहे हैं बिकॉज दिस इज अ क्वेश्चन दैट आई वुड लाइक टू आस्क ईच वन ऑफ यू यू नो व्हाट वुड वी डू इन दैट पोजिशन नाउ दैट पर्टिकुलर नक्सली पीड़ित इट्स कॉल्ड द बस्तरी द बीजापुर नक्सली पीड़ित संघर्ष समिति दे आर ऑल्सो दैट वे पार्ट ऑफ यू नो द सेम फॉर्मेशंस यू नो इंक्लूडिंग अग्नि एंड सो ऑन बट एज आई सेड There is a difference which we have to recognize. The Agni members of the Samajik Ekta Manch in Jagdalpur and members of that formation there and members of these kind of formations there, there is a difference between the two, you know, and we have to recognize it. I mean, at least I feel that's jaruri hai. And wo jaruri isliye hai, taki hum unke saath mein hum converse kar sake, hum unse baatcheet kar sake, hum unke saath bhi engage karein, kyunki agar hum unke saath mein engage nahi karenge, to wahi log hain jo राइट विंग फॉर्मेशंस में उनको उनका यूज़ किया जाता है और अगर फिर बजरंग दल अगर बढ़ रहा है अगर यू नो पूरे सैफ्रनाइजेशन हो रहा है देन वी हैव आसेस टू ब्लेम यू नो आर अरोगेंस एंड यू नो आर एलिटिज्म आर लैंग्वेज एवरीथिंग यू नो वी आर लाइक अ डिफरेंट ट्राइब ऑल टुगेदर हमारे आम जनता के साथ में हम लोग कटे हुए लोग हैं आई फील और हम लोग को बहुत ज़रूरी है अगर हमको अपना देश बचाना है तो हम लोग को बहुत ज़रूरी है कि हम अपने अपने किलों से निकलें हम आम जनता के साथ में मिलें हम अपनी परिभाषाओं को फिर से टटोलें और हम फिर से सोचें नए ढंग से सोचें और हम सबसे बातचीत करें हमारे ओपोनेंट से भी हम बातचीत करें हम हमारा आर्ग्यूमेंट रखें हम लड़ें वी बी द आर्ग्यूमेंटेटिव इंडियन We fight for our rights. We fight for democracy. We fight for equality. We fight for freedom. We fight for liberty. If we believe in it, we fight. But we fight, in my opinion at least, we fight openly. I feel about that very, very strongly. But unfortunately, what happens is that we, very easily, we condemn some of these people, you know, as a violent mob. हमारे पर एक वायलेंट मॉब का अटैक हुआ हमने भी प्रेस रिलीज उस समय जो निकाला जो भी हमारे साथियों ने या जो भी इसी तरह का मतलब एक मॉब ने हमको एज वो मॉब एक इनविजिबल था एक अदृश्य मॉब था उसका कोई आइडेंटिटी नहीं था उसका कोई कारण नहीं था यह है हमारी सच्चाई और यही है मेरी पीड़ा क्योंकि मुझे लगता है अगर हम सच नहीं बोल सकते हैं अपने आप से नहीं बोल सकते हैं अपने समूहों में नहीं बोल सकते हैं अपनी पार्टीज में नहीं बोल सकते हैं तो हम लोगों के सामने सचमुच यू नो कोई होप नहीं है सो सिमिलरली फॉर एग्जाम्पल आई हैव फाउंड एंड आई वुड लाइक टू से दैट ओपनली इवन दो यू नो आई एम पार्ट ऑफ दोज ग्रुप्स दैट फॉर एग्जाम्पल इट इज ईजियर फॉर अस और यू नो दैट वी मे टेक अप एन इशू नॉट ईजियर आई मीन दैट दोज इशूज वी हैव टू फाइट अगेंस्ट यू नो वॉर कैन नॉट बी वेज्ड ऑन विमेन्स बॉडीज So we have to fight against sexual violence. But why don't we then we also take up cases when an IED blast victim, you know, may teen mahilaen mar jati hain. Sexual violence aur hatya ya uska mrityu. Kya isme kuch antar hai? But we don't. I've tried to broach it in my team. And there is a certain kind of a silence, there's a certain kind of a whatever. So then what does it mean? It means that, you know, aap collateral damage aapko koi ho jaye, to aapko farak nahi padta hai. Aur aapko kyun nahi padta hai? Kyunki aap nahi mar rahe hain. Aapka vyakti nahi mar raha hai. Aapka parivar nahi mar raha hai. आपको कुछ फर्क नहीं पड़ता है, आपके लिए वो केवल एक आर्ग्यूमेंट है, एक आइडिया है. दैट इज वाई ऑल ऑफ वी आर लिविंग वेरी सिक्योर लाइव्स, वेरी प्रिविलेज लाइव्स. बट देर आर पीपल ऑन द ग्राउंड हु आर एवरी डे फॉर यू नो इट इज अ क्वेश्चन फॉर देम एवरी डे. द नंबर ऑफ बॉडीज दैट आई मे हैव सीन एज अ रिसर्चर और एन एक्टिविस्ट विच नम्स मी, घृणा से आप भर जाते हैं. जैसे अभी ये जो सोनकू और बिजलू की मैं आपको बात कहूँ, तो सोनकू और बिजलू का जो आफ्टर थ्री डेज व्हेन दैट गॉट अ बॉडी, आई हैव नेवर सीन अ ह्यूमन बॉडी लाइक दैट. द फैमिली नेवर इवन ओपन दैट ब्लैक प्लास्टिक बिकॉज दे वर ऑल काइंड ऑफ यू नो इंसेक्ट्स कमिंग आउट ऑफ दैट. एंड द फेसेस विच दे हैड अनकवर्ड वर दिस बिग, दे वर वाइट प्लास्टिक लाइक फेसेस, यू नो ह्यूज. दे डिडंट लुक लाइक एनी ह्यूमन बींग वन हैज एवर सीन. But if that is your son, I mean, I don't have daughters and sons. I mean, I have a dog whom I love, Somari, uska naam hai. But agar Somari ko bhi main us tarah se dekhungi, to mere liye bahut kashtday hoga. To unke liye kaisa hota hoga? Similarly, जैसे अभी हम कई बार हमारे जैसे अभी फैक्ट फाइंडिंग्स में ही, जैसे अभी इंक्रीजिंगली जो मैंने आपको बताया, जैसे अभी डीआरजी है, डीआरजी में अभी 50% जो लोग हैं वो सरेंडर्ड मिलिटेंट्स हैं एंड द अदर 50% हैव कम थ्रू रेगुलर एडवर्टीजमेंट. नाउ दिस सरेंडर्ड मिलिटेंट्स ऑफन यू नो वॉट हैपन्स इज दैट इन द एक्सेसेस दैट हैव हैपन लाइक फेक एनकाउंटर्स, रेप, जैसे अभी गुमपाड में जो हिडमे का ही रेप हुआ, जो दंतेवाड़ा में जब नहाड़ी में फेक इनकाउंटर हुआ, नीलावाया में फेक इनकाउंटर हुआ, रेवाली में हुआ, लोग जो जिनका नाम बोल रहे थे वो अक्सर यही लोग होते हैं. यू नो सुदेल से बुद्रू था, आयतू था, किरण था. क्यों बोलते हैं वो उनका नाम? क्योंकि वो उनको जानते हैं. उनके अलावा दूसरे लोग भी थे मगर वो उनको जानते हैं इसलिए वो उनका नाम लेते हैं. तो इस केस में एक तो ट्रेजेडी ये है कि जिस तरह से वो शुरुआती दौर में 2005-06 में पूरा बर्डन वॉज लेड ऑन द शोल्डर्स ऑफ द एसपीओस एंड द पैरामिलिट्री गॉट स्कॉट फ्री, जबकि उस समय अकॉर्डिंग टू दिस सुप्रीम कोर्ट जजमेंट इट्सेल्फ उस समय केवल 3,000 थे शुरुआती दौर में, और एकदम शुरुआती में तो थे ही नहीं एसपीओस. वो तो दिसंबर 2005 में तो रिक्रूटमेंट शुरू हुआ उनका और 2006 तक तो 3,000 हुए, बाद में अंत तक वो 6,000 हुए. उसी समय में 40,000 पैरामिलिट्री था उस समय. आज बस्तर में इज द मोस्ट मिलिटराइज जोन इन द कंट्री. आई डोंट नो व्हाट इज द फिगर नाउ, वेदर इट्स 70,000 और व्हाट, आई डोंट नो. बट द पॉइंट इज दैट यू नो देर आर दीज पीपल, देर आर दीज आर ऑल पीपल हु हैव टू बी हेल्ड अकाउंटेबल समवेयर. बट किस पे बर्डन आता है? तो वही बुद्रू, वही किरण, वही आयतू पे ही फिर से पूरी बात आके रुक जाती है. Increasingly what we are finding is that केवल बुलेट से फेक एनकाउंटर नहीं हो रहा है, अब छुरा चला रहे हैं, मारने के बाद या मारने के पहले कान काट रहे हैं, हाथ काट रहे हैं. हमारे फैक्ट फाइंडिंग्स में हम उतना ही पॉइंट करते हैं, हम ये नहीं पॉइंट करते या ये नहीं सोचते या उसके बाद हम ये प्रश्न नहीं पूछते कि ऐसा क्यों हो रहा है, क्या ये संभव है कि ये वही काम ये लोग पहले जब माओवादियों के साथ में जब थे वो तो ऐसा करते हैं, हम जानते हैं वो लोग ऐसा करते हैं, वो लोग वहाँ से ये करके आए और यहाँ पे उनको मतलब दे बिकेम पार्ट ऑफ अ स्टेट फोर्स एंड द स्टेट शुड नॉट गेट देम टू डू दैट, बट मे बी द स्टेट डज दैट टू गिव अ डायरेक्ट मैसेज कि ठीक है तुम लोग ऐसा कर सकते हो, हम भी ऐसा कर सकते हैं. यू नो वो तो स्टेट तो हम जान ही रहे हैं, उसको रूल ऑफ लॉ का कोई रिस्पेक्ट नहीं है. सो इन अ वेरी दिस वे इनसे भी वो ये करवाते हैं, पर हमारे ऑब्जर्वेशन में फिर हम लोग की बात उतनी तक ही रह जाती है. यू नो कि हाँ हिडमे का कान कटा हुआ था, हाँ उसके ब्रेस्ट का निपल कटा हुआ था, बट यू नो वी आर नॉट देन यू नो गोइंग फर्दर एंड सेइंग कि यही काम अंदर वाले भी जब करते हैं तो ये बात नहीं आती है. और दूसरा कि वही लोग वहीं से भी सीखे हैं, सीख कर आए हैं, और वो जो बुद्रू है या वो आयतू है, अगेन आई मीन देन वी नीड टू आस्क दिस क्वेश्चन, ये जो 10-10 साल अंदर रह के ये काम कर रहे हैं तो फिर ये प्रश्न तो पूछना पड़ेगा. ये तो कोई आम क्रिमिनल गैंग तो है नहीं जो उन्होंने ज्वाइन किया था, ये तो एक आइडियोलॉजिकल मूवमेंट है. सो ऐसे कैसे होता है कि इस प्रकार के आइडियोलॉजिकल मूवमेंट 10-10 साल भी आप रह लिए मगर इतना भी आप नहीं समझे, कैसे कैसे होता है. So the point here is that an action that we deem as in quote a crime when done by a state actor, if deemed not a crime when carried out by a non-state actor, then this is something that ordinary citizens at least who are watching us are not able to understand. Especially when the only category that is exempted are those who are in the revolutionary camp. For if the same act was committed by any other non-state actor of society, for example a civilian, or a member of the right wing, a Bajrang Sena person, she or he would not be exempt. So it is clearly the underlining of a universal value that will be understood by all. Only this, you know, can, in my at least opinion, I feel only this can take a society forward and become an argument to motivate political morality and responsibility. When we say democratic rights, there is a sense of demanding this right from the system. But it is not only the system that gives you the right, it is also each other. We need to be able to respect also the right of the other. There has been considerable debate in the civil liberties movement on state violence and private violence, the argument being that one cannot equate the two. Indeed, one cannot. However, even though there may not be a complete symmetry, the fact is that there is a link between state violence and private violence, and also that unquestioned private violence of one set of actors legitimizes private violence of another set of actors. So I come back to the question that, you know, I would like to ask again, that why do we tend to be silent about Maoist violence? Why don't we also question Maoist excesses? There may be some who do not question because they do not agree with the kind of viewpoint that I am holding. But there are also others who do not question because there is no room for disagreement or dissent in Maoist politics. Locally, for example, if you do not agree with the Maoists, what can you do? There's no available public window, you know, where you can go, you can give a petition, or you can, you know, kisi se aap jaake baat kare. Aisi to koi jagah nahi. And that too, you know, ki aap puche bhi, and that you come out, you know, with dignity, you know, after the disagreement, you know, and that your life remains safe. And so this is almost impossible. So it does not take much notice, you know, to see that the Maoists do not tolerate people who disagree with them. Karl Marx said, question everything. Yet, questioning the Maoists is often an act of courage, not only at the local level, but also at intellectual levels. Now, the other question which I would like to pose, and I do not have that much time, is that, you know, why are the Adivasis being made to bear the burden of the Revolutionary War? Now, I know you will say that you're saying as though they have no agency. Aap ye keh sakte hai mujhe. Par phir bhi mujhe lagta hai ki bahut hi, matlab bahut jyada aap un par, you know, ek pura burden hai. And I feel that they are fighting against a development paradigm that we are actually, that we are the ones who are beneficiaries of that paradigm. And would it be useful to, for example, ask a counterfactual question? To ask the what-if question. To ask, for example, what would have been the situation if the Maoists had waged an open struggle through democratic means, like the CPI in Bastar. Now, CPI ko dono taraf se jhelna pada hai. Unko Maoists ne bhi target kiya hai, aur unko state ne bhi target kiya hai. Maoists bol kar. Aisa to bahut hua hai. Bahut log mare bhi gaye hain, bahut logon ko jail hui hai. Is tarah ka bahut hua hai. On the left spectrum, the CPI may be thought to be less radical, but on the ground, one finds that they have led many successful battles against anti-people industrialization in Bastar, the latest being the long struggle against Tata Steel in Lohandiguda, forcing Tata Steel to withdraw. Certainly, I feel that the cost that, you know, has been borne by the people in this war, I think if it was a completely open battle, I think the cost would be less. I also feel that it would have been possible, or it would be possible, to engage and involve large segments of the Bastar society who care, but today remain mute spectators in the face of so much violence that it leaves you numb. This is, of course, not to mention those who remain unaffected by the war and who are rarely targets by the Maoists, some of these chaps I mentioned, like jo Jagdalpur mein real estate business kar rahe hain, iske liye aise aur bahut hain, bahut businessmen hain, you know, local traders, wo sab type ke bhi kai log hain. Now it is often argued that it is because of the Maoists that the land, forests and minerals are still safe in Bastar. But it can also be argued that the people are not able to work on, leave alone enjoy their lands and forests. That so violent has been the onslaught that their way of life has been snatched away from them. There was a time when the Adivasis used to roam about in the jungle without fear. They did wield the bow and arrow, the axe or tangia, as and when they needed to use force in order to survive in their daily lives. They knew the art of hunting as well as living in harmony with nature as taught to them by their forefathers, foremothers. There was, of course, the occasional instance of a suicide or a murder, but these were only once in a while. And the closest they came to the act of killing or death was while hunting in the jungle or the weekly korhat ya murga bajar, when they would bet on a handsome cock and the cockfight would be watched with much enjoyment, which happens today also, but war zone mein aksar utna bhi nahi ho pata hai. The government arrived on the scene to make them into citizens of the republic, though welfare measures reached them only reluctantly. The Naxalites arrived. Slowly their actions became more intense, and the hills and the forests were converted into a battlefield and them into insurgents. Guns became familiar and death an all too frequent visitor at their doorstep. It has come in many guises, as has displacement, and since then a lot has happened, and it is 12 years now. But we must not forget that there was another life they lived once. Right to life is a natural right as well as a fundamental right. It is the most basic of all democratic rights. The Adivasis of Bastar cry softly. They lift up their arms. Usually, aap griefing ke samay aap dekhenge, wo aise haath aise uthate, aise karte rote. They sort of rock themselves like that. ग्रेव में यू नो वो खुद चित्रों में होंगे या बहुत उनके कम एक लुंगी ओढ़े होंगे, मगर उस डेड बॉडी के ऊपर नई नई बेडशीट्स, यू नो नई नई साड़ियाँ वो उस पर डालते हैं, एक के ऊपर एक, बिलीविंग यू नो दैट द पर्सन शुड बी वॉर्म यू नो इन देयर न्यू अबोर्ड. दे ऑफर द बॉडी यू नो एडिबल आइटम्स लाइक कॉर्न and hang near the grave the person's belongings, you know, like bangles, clothes, umbrellas, vessels, so that the spirit may not be in want. When the stench of death pervades the air too often and for too long, at least sometimes those who live close to nature and see the seasons change must long for an end to this strife. This is the most overwhelming question we face. When and how will all this end? What are the rights and the wrongs of this war? What can be done? What should we do? The implication of the systematic, you know, marginalization and violence of the tribal communities is a big loss for all of us and a big failure. It's loss because what we have been witnessing in the last decade in Bastar is a death of a civilization. It's a failure because, like in other parts of the world, in India too, we have not been able to appreciate or respect the indigenous peoples, their way of life, their knowledge, their histories, and their aspirations. The government, the public, and often even the rebel groups have tended to relate with them out of relative ignorance. Our nation is not fully conscious of itself. It does not know of its own riches. It does not know, for example, that a place like Bastar is not only rich in minerals and forests, but that the tribal world holds within itself rich human resources and knowledge systems. The tribal people of Bastar may seem to be underdeveloped to someone who understands development only in material terms, who may have only one idea of what being modern is about, and therefore the mainstreaming of modernity, the mukhyadhara, to which all who are judged aberrant or seen to be lagging behind need to be brought to. In this imagination, the aberrant is not acceptable unless he desires to be part of the mukhyadhara. It is often not understood that a society and a people may have less in some respects and may be able to benefit from scientific advancements in some ways, and yet in other ways they may be far more advanced than their developed counterparts, even those who belong to the higher castes and classes. This imagination aims at a kind of economic homogenization of society, where its members desire the same consumer goods, resulting in similar habits and lifestyles. But this homogenization is only at the consumer end of the bargain and does not question structural inequalities, even remotely. The continuing concentration of wealth and power in a few hands and the resultant widening of inequality is not seen as a problem. Increasingly, the mukhyadhara involves an imagination not only of economic, but also of cultural, cultural homogenization, with the Hindutva ideology at its core. Since this imagination is being propagated by the dominant sections of society, it excludes other possible ways of life, including those that have been practiced by the tribals for centuries. The way of life has proved in its simplicity to be sustainable, environment friendly, and the one that depends on cooperation and mutual aid and therefore keeps the community alive. Tribal economies have also proved to be largely self-sufficient, and the extent to which they are able to be self-reliant is awe-inspiring. Unfortunately, all that is getting lost. The tragedy is that in this process, where the rhetoric is of their development or emancipation, what is happening is that whatever they had is also being wrested away from them. And in reality, their survival is at stake. The tribal residents of the war zone of Bastar have become prisoners of state repression and class war. And for them, this process hides a greater loss, a loss of self. I do not claim that whatever I have shared with you today is the only truth, but it is truthful. Perhaps this is what Virginia Woolf meant when she said, arrange whatever pieces come your way. And I add, as best as you can. I do hope the story of the downside of the war in Bastar so far will allow us to take stock of the situation and fight for our ideals by exploring other powerful ways of fighting the authoritarian Indian state in order to achieve equality, justice, and liberty for all, and that we always remain, argumentative Indians. Thanks.
Thank you, Ms. Bhatia.